We studied something really awesome last week, chapter 4 of the book of Revelation. And the concluding passage, verse 11, "Worthy are you, our Lord, our God, to receive the glory and the honor and dominion, for you created all things, by your will they were brought into being and were created." In short, paralleling Psalm 19 verse 1, we were created for His pleasure. Now, what is amazing is that actually chapters 4 and 5 is one chapter. It's one whole setting. There is no separation. It's a continuum. And we are going to find out in chapter 5 what this penultimate goal of our creation has got to do with. You see, there's a beginning, there's an end. And chapter 5 tells you where the believer in Mashiach is going to end up. Has anybody figured that out up to now? I don't think so. So let's read. Okay. Verse 1 of chapter 5. "And I saw laying on an open hand of him who was seated on the throne with a scroll written within and on the back and closed and sealed with seven seals." Right. Now the first thing you have to understand is that I saw lying open the open hand of him who was seated on the throne. When you see the open hand, it's saying that this hand receives everything. The hand of God receives everything. Every report, both good and bad, is received by this hand. Because He is the judge. You understand? He sits on the bema seat. He sits on the white throne judgment. And it says, was given to him. He didn't take it. It was given to him. A scroll written within, that is on the inside and on the outside, closed and sealed with seven. So what we have to do is, what has this got to do with a scroll? What does the scroll parallel that the book of Revelation is now talking about? And this scroll, you will come to find out, has a very deep meaning in it. So turn to Ezekiel chapter 2 and verse 9. Ezekiel chapter 2. "And when I looked, behold, a hand was stretched out to me." Same hand. Ezekiel is seeing a very parallel, similar situation that Yohanan in the book of Revelation was witnessing. This is the first time it appears in the Bible, the scroll. "A scroll was in it, and he spread it before me, and it was written within and on the back." Can you see the same thing? So what Yohanan is going to see is a very parallel scenario, not the same scenario, a very parallel scenario that Ezekiel was presented. How many realize that that has happened up to now? Until I told you, none of you. Isn't it amazing how the Holy Spirit will reveal? That's why Yeshua says, "I am going and I will send you a comforter." He is the Spirit of truth. He bears witness to the word. Amen. Let's read on. Verse 10. "And he spread it before me, and it was written within and on the back, and written on it were the words of lamentation and mourning and woe." This scroll that Ezekiel saw in the hands of the Lord was a scroll of what? Judgment. Sorry? It's a scroll, when it's written on the within and on the back, it has to do with judgment. Quickly jump from here to Zechariah chapter 5, verse 3. Then he said to me, okay, let's look at verse 1, chapter 5. Again, I lifted up my eyes, and behold, I saw a scroll flying in the air. And the angelos, or the messenger, said, what do you see? And I said, a flying scroll. Now, it's giving you more depth to what Ezekiel saw. Any one of you connected a parallel from Zechariah 5 to Ezekiel 2? Janaka? So we're going to learn something. That's why I said today's teaching is far more deep than last week. And I said a flying scroll, its length is 20 cubits or 30 feet, and its breadth is 10 cubits or 15 feet. What is this? What is this talking about? Why the length? What are the dimensions? It's the tabernacle of the Lord. The scroll is giving you the same dimensions of the tabernacle. Let's read on. Then he said to me, this is the curse. That's why I said what Ezekiel sees is a judgment. Because in Zechariah, it's giving you more depth, more definition. This is a curse that goes out over the face of the whole land of Israel. For everyone who steals shall be cut off henceforth. According to it, the curse is written on the subject of the scroll. Stealing. If you look at stealing, it is on the second tablet of the 10 words that God spoke to Moses on Mount Sinai. It's right in the middle. Robbing your neighbor. Covetousness. Okay? And everyone who swears falsely shall be cut off. Swearing is taking the name of the Lord, thy God, in vain. Again, if you take these two words that were on two stone tablets, one has to do with God, one has to do with your neighbor. But the beauty of this statement is that if you count its ascendancy or descendancy, as far as the Lord's speaking it, it's exactly in the middle. Which tells you that his judgment is being passed on Israel based on the 10 words, what we call the 10 commandments. A judgment is being passed on the nation, right? Because the tabernacle is the measuring rod for God's word. Okay? Thus says the Lord of hosts, this is Adonai Sabaoth, old men and old women shall again dwell in Jerusalem. Oh, sorry, what am I saying? Sorry. Zechariah 5. Henceforth, according to it, I will bring the curse forth, says the Lord of hosts, and it shall enter the house of the thief and into the house of him who swears. So the thief here is considered a man who has robbed his neighbor. Not somebody who's coming to rob, but somebody who has robbed his neighbor according to the 10 words of Mount Sinai, right? Exodus 20. And shall enter the house of the thief and into the house of him who swears falsely by my name. Blasphemy. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. So basically, if you look at it, these two sins that have passed upon the land are based on the two stone tablets, right? And it shall abide in the midst of his house and shall consume it, both its timber and its stones. In short, I will break the whole house down. It's talking about decimation and judgment, or judgment and decimation. Then the messenger who I talked with came forward and said to me, lift up now your eyes and see what is that goes forth. And I said, what is it? What does it symbolize? And he said, this goes forth an ephah, a size vessel for separate grains and collected together. This, he continued, is a symbol of the sinners mentioned above, and it's resemblance of their iniquity through the whole land, which parallels what Amos the prophet was shown in Amos chapter 5, 8, chapter 8 and verse 5. And behold, a round flat weight of lead was lifted, and there sat, there were some people today making fun of us, a woman sat in the midst of the ephah size vessel. So that tells you where God sees them in the body of Christ. And he said, pointing at that woman, this is lawlessness. And he thrust her back exactly where she should have been, shut up inside the ephah. And he cast the weight of lead over its mouth that she can't come out. Why? Because the sound of her voice would have lifted any other lid. So he puts a lead weight and covers it. Then I lifted up my eyes and looked, and behold, there were two women coming forward. The wind was in their wings, for they had wings like the wings of a stork. Stop there. What is a stork? An unclean bird. It is not kosher. And they lifted up the ephah sized vessel between the earth and the heavens. Then I said to the messenger who talked with me, where are they taking the ephah sized vessel? And he said, to the land of Shinar, Babylon, to build a house, and when it is finished, to set up the ephah sized vessel, the symbol of such sinners and their guilt, thereupon its own base. Now let me just amplify this a bit. This is a vision that Zechariah the prophet saw about the end times. And what God is showing us in the book of Revelation is that in the end times, Babylon has to be rebuilt. Babylon is going to become the center of the world's civilization, which is based on sin. And that is the judgment that's coming upon the earth in Revelation chapter 5. Now can you see the parable? It's talking about those who steal, covetousness, and those who blaspheme the name of the Lord. So in short, the Lord is showing Yohanan a scroll of judgment which is going to come upon the land when? After the rapture. That's the main thing. The church or the body of believers is already in heaven. And then he sees a judgment, a scroll of judgment with seven seals. Right? Sealing it, giving it a godly seal, but being passed down for judgment. Okay? Now, the next thing we have to look at is, what is this seal? It is a judgment-based seal. But what is this scroll? The scroll, you will find eventually, goes right back to Bereshit. A scroll was given, right, as a title deed. This scroll was the title deed that was initially before Adam in the hands of Lucifer. He owned, was given by God. That's why there are seals in front, and it's written on the inside and on the back. Because there were two sets of people who handled this title deed. First, Lucifer. When Lucifer fell, the new recreated earth title deed was given to Adam. And Satan, through the fall of Adam, has now taken it, and now it's back in his hands. And those who control the world are under the kingdom of Satan and not under the kingdom of God. And that's why Yohanan, when he first comes, who came to baptize, he said, the kingdom of God is at hand. When Yeshua came, he says, the kingdom of God is at hand. And what he's announcing is that Yeshua has come as the suffering Messiah to pay a price, to begin a process, to take the title deed back. Okay? Did you ever see that in Revelation chapter 5? The next thing, it says, chapter 5 verse 2, there is a huge problem that John is facing. I saw a strong angel announce in a loud voice, who is worthy to open the scroll? Who is entitled and deserves and is morally fit to break its seals, and no one in heaven or on earth or under earth in the realm of the dead of Hades was able to open the scroll or take a single look at it. And I wept audibly and bitterly because no one was able to open the scroll. What is this talking about? It's saying that this scroll can only be opened by somebody who was actually given a deed, a legal ownership. Lucifer cannot open the scroll anymore because he's fallen. Adam,
now
listen to this. Adam couldn't open the scroll because he fell. According to Genesis chapter 5, the sons and children of Adam could not open the scroll because they were in the fallen state. But the person who could open the scroll had to be somebody made, created by God Himself. And there are only two created by God Himself: Lucifer, son of the morning. You were made in perfection. Fallen. Adam, let us make man in our image. Fallen. Who else is made in the image of God that came to this earth? Yeshua the Messiah. Nobody else can qualify because the children of Adam were made by Adam. Get it? But here, the two people who had the title deed, both were created by God directly. You see that? Have you ever looked at it from that point of view? Lucifer was created by God Himself, by Yeshua Himself. Created in perfection. There was no flaw until iniquity was found. Adam was created perfect until iniquity was found. Can you see the parallel? And therefore, the only person in heaven and on earth who could take this title deed had to be somebody who was created by God in His image. And there was no one except Yeshua the Messiah. Now you understand why He was created. I will put enmity between you and the woman, her seed and his seed, and her seed shall crush you. It had to be God, but it also had to be man. Do you see that? It had to be somebody perfect. Because the only two perfect creations both fell. Has that ever impacted you in that manner? Yeah? Profound, isn't it? Profound. If you look at Genesis chapter 2, 16 to 17, Genesis 3, 15, you will find that that was the strategy of Satan to take the title deed back. That is why Genesis chapter 2 and 3 are so important. It is him stealing. Hold on. Did what I tell you hit you when I just told you Genesis 2 and 3? No. I didn't think so. Let me refresh you. In Zechariah chapter 5, the flying scroll had to do with two sins that were in the middle of the 10 words. Robbery and blasphemy. Did God really tell you not to eat of that tree? No. If you eat of the tree, you can be like, he blasphemed God. He blasphemed God. And the sixth thing is, he robbed him. He robbed him of his title. The same two sins. As in Zechariah 5, I told you, that's why I asked Bhushan this morning, did you figure it out, boy? Did you figure it out? You won't. You understand? Now you get it. It's the same two sins which Zechariah is saying that Israel committed because their great, 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 great father of sin was Satan. He did it first. And that's why you see that in Bereshit. He blasphemes God and then he robs. Yeah? Get it? Good. So basically, you will find that when you look at the scriptures, Satan's retaking strategy, just look at John chapter 12, verse 31. Are we getting interested here? Yeah, it's powerful. It's far more deeper than last week. John 12, 31. Now the judgment of this world is coming. The sentence is now being passed on the world. Now the ruler, the evil genius, the prince of this world shall be cast out. So the whole strategy of Yeshua, who is worthy to take the scroll, is one thing, with one thing in mind, to take the title deed of the prince who controls this world. Can you see how that parallels in now? Okay, now what we are going to learn now is something a bit deeper, right? Let's just... Just to give you some background to that first fall and first... When Satan fell, God creates something new again, the earth. And Job 38 tells you that the angels sang for joy when they saw this recreation. Why? Because he was creating a new title deed. The earth that was given to Lucifer was destroyed, and now he's recreating it to give it to Adam. And that's what Job is talking about, right? But if you look at Leviticus 25:25, then you will understand something very profound. That's why I say, take Torah out and you don't understand the book of Revelation. Leviticus 25:25. If your brother has become poor and has sold some of his property to any of his kin, any of his kin can come to redeem it, he shall be allowed to redeem whatever his brother has sold. Can you see something happening here? It's a law. It's a biblical law of the blood. The seed of the woman, right, will come back according to the law of Leviticus. That is why he says, I shall put enmity between your seed and her seed, but her seed shall crush you, because her seed will end up in the Messiah who has to come back according to the Levitical law to take back what land was given to you. It's a law. I told you, Bhushan found this all out by this morning. I had gone for a haircut. I challenged him last night. I said, Bhushan, you find out, right? And let's see whether you're going to beat me to it, right? Now, let's look at... Turn to Numbers 35, verse 16. Numbers 35, verse 16. Numbers 35:16. But if he struck him down with an instrument of iron so that he died, he is the murderer, and the murderer shall surely be put to death. If he struck down by throwing a stone by which a person may die, he died, and he is a murderer, and the murderer shall surely be put to death. Right? And verse 19 says, the avenger of the blood himself shall slay the murderer when he meets him, and he shall slay him. Am I telling you something that is ringing a bell now? If you take Leviticus 25 and Numbers 35, there is a law given in both instances, talking about a chapter in the Bible, in the Tanakh, which will now tell you why it's there
because it's the only chapter that talks to you about a kinsman redeemer. Ruth. That is the main thing that chapter is there to explain to you, that this flying scroll, this title of judgment for this earth, can only be redeemed by a kinsman redeemer, because the law says if your brother, remember, created by God, only three created. One was an angel, one was a human, one was God who came to redeem what man had lost. Yeshua is coming back to this earth in Revelation chapter 5, breaking the title deed seals, because he has paid for it with his blood. But now he's coming back for what? To put an end to the murderer. You shall not die, said Lucifer or Satan to Eve, but they did that. So the first murder was actually the death of Adam and Eve, because death came to them through disobedience. Book of Romans tells us that. Am I correct? This is heavy stuff, guys. If you can just look at the picture. The title deed was not only stolen, but blasphemy came in, which ended up in murder. And according to the law of Leviticus and the law of Numbers, the land or the title deed which went to somebody else through your brother can be redeemed by a kinsman redeemer. But if he is murdered also, the kinsman redeemer can redeem the land plus kill the murderer. God's law. Now let's read. If Bhushan could have figured all this out, I'd have taken him for lunch today. Verse 5. Then one of the elders of the heavenly Sanhedrin said to me, stop reading. See, the lion of the tribe of Yehuda, the source of David, has won and overcome and conquered. He can open the scroll and break the seven seals. Why? Because before the foundations of this world, God set aside a lamb. Why a lamb? Because he was the Passover lamb. And if you had the blood on your doorpost, the angel of death could not come to your house. You understand? And in the new covenant, he reverses that role. And it's not the wine first, but he breaks the bread first. Because now he's not only opening up the title deed to this earth, he's opening up the title deed to heaven. You get it? The people who are born of the Spirit can now understand the things of the Spirit. And where does the Spirit come from? From heaven. I mean, this is heavy stuff. This is heavy stuff which you really need to, which Bhushan was going to figure out last night. As I said, go for it, baby. Let's check it out. Right? And I saw a lamb standing as though it had been slain. Why? Because it was the Passover lamb. With seven horns and seven eyes. Basically, the seven horns stand for the authority. Right? Horns are to do with authority. And seven eyes, you will find that in the book of Zechariah, right? The all-seeing eyes, right? Which are the seven spirits of God, Isaiah 11, 2, right? And Zechariah 3, 8, who have been sent on duty far and wide into all the earth. And he went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who sat on the throne. And when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders of heaven prostrated themselves before the Lamb, each holding a lute or a harp, and they had golden bowls of incense, of fragrance, of gums and burnings, which are the prayers of the people of the saints. And now they sing a new song. You are worthy to take the scroll and to break the seals that are for you were slain. Here is the payment for the title deed. You were slain, and with your blood you purchased men unto God from every tribe and language, people and nation. You have made them a kingdom, a royal race of priests to serve God, and shall rule as kings over the earth. Hold on. There are two groups here. There are two groups here if you miss it out. You have purchased men with your blood. But there are two groups. There are kings and there are priests. Who rule and reign? Kings. Priests don't rule. Priests are servants. The raptured church will come back to rule and reign. The martyred tribulation saints will be in the millennium temple serving God. Two different groups. Two different groups, two different time frames, two different destinations. Two different future roles in the millennium kingdom. And that parallels what the Lord tells Peter when he says, Lord, we have left everything. What are we gaining? And he said, you shall sit and judge the 12 tribes of Israel. When will that be? In the millennium kingdom. In the millennium kingdom. Let's read on. Then I looked and I heard the voices of many angels of every side of the throne and of the living creatures and of the elders. And they numbered 10,000, right? Saying in a loud voice, deserved is the Lamb who was sacrificed to receive all power and riches and wisdom and mighty and honor and majesty, splendor and blessings. And I heard every creature, everything in heaven and on earth, under the earth, in Hades, the places of the departed spirits, and on the sea, and of all, cry together to him who is seated on the throne, to the Lamb, ascribe the blessings, the honor, the majesty, the glory and the splendor, the power, might and dominion forever and forever throughout eternities. Then the four living creatures said, Amen, so be it. And the elders of the heavenly sanctuary prostrated themselves and worshipped him who lives forever and forever. Please understand that this particular chapter is telling you the same thing that's going to continue in Revelation chapter 19. Everybody is by this time in heaven. Ten thousands. The raptured church and all the tribulation martyrs are already in heaven because they have been taken. The fullness of the Gentiles is over and the tribulation is already over. And now, he who sits on the throne has broken the seals because there's only two things that has to take place. Judgment of the robber and the retaking of the earth, and everybody who is in it is now in a state of desecration, and what has desecrated the earth has to be purified, and the only way it can be purified is with fire. So their blood has to be spilled on the earth and then cleansed with fire, which means a total recreation. So basically what John is seeing is the raptured saints in heaven, and the final rationale of the law of Leviticus 25 and Numbers 35, that the kinsman redeemer, see, he has to be of the same bloodline. Adam did not have a bloodline before him, therefore he had to be created by God. Yeshua did not have a bloodline because he is God himself. Lucifer is an angel who ruled and reigned on this earth. First title deed. Taken, fallen, destroyed, given to Adam. Robbed, murdered. And Yeshua says, I have paid the price for the land. I have to fulfill Numbers 35. I have to come. Because he murdered the one made in the image of God, Adam. I need to come and put an end to it. And what this is starting off from Revelation chapter 6 to Revelation 19 is a totally different realm. Totally different realm with one thing. Judgment, retribution, condemnation. So anybody who teaches that there is going to be a mid-tribulation rapture and a post-tribulation rapture is telling you that as a believer in the Messiah, you are under judgment, which totally goes against Romans 8:1, there's no katakrimia. 1 Thessalonians 5, 4 and 5 clearly says that we are children of the light. You understand? 1 Thessalonians 5 says, brethren, we are not destined for wrath. What is the wrath? He's telling the church in Thessalonica. Revelation chapter 6 to 19. Now do you understand when people teach on the book of Revelation, how misguided they are? Because they don't understand that the Torah is standing in the book of Revelation and telling the people what God is expecting of the Messiah to do according to the law. That's why he says in Matthew 5, I have come to fulfill the law. Take the disciples' prayer. The church has named it as the Lord's prayer. Wrong. Wrong. It is the disciples' prayer. Lord, teach us how to pray. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. The Torah is in heaven, the law is in heaven, and the Messiah is going to fulfill everything, every jot, every tittle, and Satan is going to be judged with the false prophet and the Antichrist and thrown into the lake of fire, because they are the three who have murdered men ever since creation. Now do you see how chapter 5 unfolds? It's a totally different realm. It's a totally different realm. What we are seeing is basically the Kinsman Redeemer coming finally as Yeshua himself, the husband of Ruth, the Gentile bride, right, with the Judean king. And that's what's going to conclude in Revelation 19. Shall we pray? Father, we want to give you thanks, we give you praise. Father, I know that this chapter has really blown all our minds to see, Lord, what you're showing us that is to come in the very near future. Thank you, Lord, that we are saved by your blood and the grace of the Father in heaven through our faith in you. Thank you, Lord, that we are destined to rule and reign with you as kings. Lord, we know that the tribulation martyrs will serve you as priests, for it concludes what the book of Revelation says, that the saints, the souls under the altar. But Father, you have told us today that we are destined to rule and reign with you as kings on this earth. And Father, more than that, that you have called us from darkness to light. Lord, that we are saved by the blood, who is worthy to rule in heaven, to rule on this earth. And Father, for what you've taught us today, Lord, we want to praise you, we want to thank you. And Father, this is how you told Aaron to bless the people. Ivareka kadonai vishmareka, e adonai panibileka vihunuleka, isa adonai panibileka vyashemleka shalom. The Lord will bless you, the Lord will keep you, the Lord will make his face shine upon you, the Lord will lift up his countenance and give you his shalom. Go in the peace of the Lord. Amen.